Hopefully a lot of you were with us a few weeks ago when we had the reveal for the $20 Club, where you guys raised $125,000 to build the India Boys Home. And we got to celebrate that, but we kind of hinted that maybe there was more that God was doing, and that's definitely true. And so now I want to share with you a really special moment that happened last Sunday during our 5:30 service. Check it out.
Would you guys just welcome Kias and Jay Shree? Come on. As you'll remember, with the Dollar Club, the $20 Club, we had an opportunity to meet a need and came together in a big way. And so we were able to help make contribution for the boys' dream home. And so it's been wonderful for us to be able to see the story with the Dollar Club. Is there anything you'd like to share, or anything you'd like to say?
So on behalf of all our children and staff, this is our greatest honor to be a part with you this evening. Thank you for allowing us to join your service. And really, we are so grateful to all of you for your contribution. It's actually changed the life of many children. So thank you so much for your contribution. Thank you so much, since from day one, CrossPoint is with us. Your sacrifice, your love, your prayer. So on behalf of all our staffs, this is my great honor. And let me take the opportunity to express my gratitude to all of you for your support. Thank you so much.
You're so welcome. We've heard about the needs that you have. We've heard about there's a need for a bus to be able to pick up the children and bring them to church, around $25,000 in fees for that. We've heard about a need for a doctor to come and visit and to be able to help with the medical needs of the community. And so it's around $4,500 for that. So we've heard about those needs. We did not raise the $125,000. We raised beyond that because of great love for you and for what you're doing, and because of the generosity of a lot of people here that just love you deeply. And so what we would like to do is extend beyond that with $35,000 to be able to come alongside you and love you and bless the work that you're doing. So, yes. We love you. Come on.
I'm gonna tell you, I didn't know how long Pias was gonna hug me. I've never been to India. I don't know how long Indian hugs are. I just didn't know. I just kept hugging him. I'm gonna tell you, I could feel his heart beating through his chest. And I thought, you know what, this is much bigger than a hug. It's the kingdom of God. And our heart as a church is with Pias and Jay Shree and what God is doing over there. And so grateful that we get to be a part of that together. So thank you for your generosity. A friend of mine, Rory, he shared a story with me. He's from Colorado. And it's a story. He said that when he was out in Colorado, he said, "Kevin, do you know the difference between the way a cow and a buffalo responds when a storm comes?" He said, "It's interesting." He said, "It's fascinating. It's a different response. But when the storm comes in over the mountains and when the cow sees the storm coming, the cow runs from the storm." He says the cow tries to outrun the storm, and cows aren't known for their speed. And so when the cow tries to outrun the storm, what ends up happening is the storm chases down the cow, and eventually, by running from the storm, the cow maximizes their exposure to the storm and their time in the storm, and the storm just keeps going with the cow. He said, but the buffalo have a fascinating response, an interesting response. When they see the storm come over the mountains, in that moment, the buffalo turns toward the storm, and the buffalo charges the storm. And by charging the storm, the buffalo minimizes their time in the storm, and actually the storm passes over. I thought, that's interesting. And when you think about this, I want you to think about the disciples. Here we got a picture of a cow and a buffalo. Before the Holy Spirit, we're talking about the gift of the Holy Spirit, before the disciples received the Holy Spirit, they were like the cows. They were running from the storm. In fact, Jesus told them, he said, before he went to the cross, and at that moment, they ran from trouble. But the moment they received the gift of the Holy Spirit, they became the kind of people who charged the storm. That's the difference that the Holy Spirit made in their lives. That's the difference that the Holy Spirit makes in our lives. And so when you face challenge and when you face storm and when you face adversity, you're either going to handle it like a cow or like a buffalo. And what my friend was telling me, he was saying, Kevin, it's better to be like a buffalo. Like, it's better this way. And Jesus said, we're all going to face storms. In fact, in John chapter 16, verse 33, this is after he tells him, I'm sending the Holy Spirit. Look at what he says. He says, I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. So Jesus promises us two things in this passage. First thing he says, you're going to have trouble. Like, you're going to face storms. You're going to face problems in your life. So the first thing he promises is his problems. The second thing he promises is his peace. Because you're going to face storms, but you can charge the storms because I've given you my peace. And my peace is greater than the storm. And some of you are facing storms right now. In your work, in your marriage, in your family. Maybe you've got a parenting challenge right now. This is a storm. Maybe there's a diagnosis that you just received. Heartache, hurt, betrayal, disappointment. There's this idea out there that if we follow Jesus, we're not going to have storms in life. It's not true. Jesus said we will have storms, but he said, greater is he who is in you than he that's in the storm. Because he said, I've given you my peace. I've given you my peace. And so this gift of the Holy Spirit made all the difference for the disciples, and it makes all the difference for us. That's why when Jesus was talking with them in the same passage, John 16 earlier, he tells the disciples, he gives them news. He says, I'm going to be leaving you. And they're grieving. I mean, Jesus has been the most important person in their life for 3 years. I mean, some of us, we've known the experience of losing the most important person in our life. So you know the pain attached to that. And then Jesus, look at what he tells them. After he says he's leaving them, he says, but I'm telling you the truth. It's better for you that I go away. Because if I do not go, the helper will not come to you. Talking about the Holy Spirit. But if I do go away, then I will send him to you. Jesus is saying, it's better that I go because it's only when I go that you can receive the Holy Spirit, that you can receive the Spirit of God. And so what Jesus is saying is that it's better to have the Spirit within us than to have Jesus with us. And I wonder, man, do we believe that? Like, do we really believe that? I mean, if you had the choice where you could go to a church where Jesus was the pastor, or you could be here and have the Holy Spirit, like, I wonder how many of us would be here. Because I think I would choose the church where Jesus is the pastor. I know I would, right? And for the disciples, this is not a hypothetical situation or a question. This is the real deal. Jesus saying, Jesus was their pastor. He was their shepherd. He was the one who led them in flesh for 3 years. And he's saying, it's better that you have the Holy Spirit than to have me as your pastor here. Because when you have the Holy Spirit in your life, you have the power and the presence of God with you. That the Holy Spirit within us is better than having Jesus with us. This makes all the difference. But you know, I think sometimes when we hear the words Holy Spirit, it can make us nervous. Because maybe some experiences you had in church growing up, or maybe flipping through the channels, you came across something or something you saw on YouTube. Or maybe you grew up in a church where the Holy Spirit wasn't talked about. There was a woman out at Mount Juliet campus who her father was a pastor, and she said she sat through 4,000 sermons. She said she had never heard a sermon on the Holy Spirit. Maybe in your church growing up, the Holy Spirit was like thyroid. Like, you knew it was there, and you didn't know how it worked, so you didn't talk about it. But you just hoped that it worked. And maybe that was more your experience with the Holy Spirit. Or maybe you knew somebody that talked a lot about the Holy Spirit, and they were a weirdo. But let's just be honest, they were a weirdo before the Holy Spirit. I mean, that's just... But sometimes I think our nervousness and our ignorance about the Holy Spirit can cause us to shrink back. But if we shrink back from this power that Jesus has given us, then we diminish our power and our capacity in life to live the life that he's created us for. Because the life that he has called you to is only possible in his spirit and in his strength that dwells in you. And so we're saying in this series, and we're saying, God, would you show us how to live a life that's empowered by your spirit? Would you show us how to live that kind of life so that we can fulfill the calling that you've given to us? And last week we shared how the disciples, how they went from this being afraid and they went to living this life of courage. I mean, in that moment, Peter, I mean, think about it. He was the one who denied Jesus three times. Then he receives the Holy Spirit, and now he's standing at Pentecost. He's standing before thousands of people, and he's boldly proclaiming the message that he shrunk back from sharing. Now he's boldly proclaiming, and the Holy Spirit made all the difference. That's what made the difference. Look, in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, Peter's up there and he's preaching, and then the people, after they hear the message, they hear the gospel, they hear the good news about Jesus, they're cut to the heart. And so they ask him, look what they say. They ask him, they're like, what must we do to be saved? What must we do to be made right with God? What do we have to do to get back right? How do we get this? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so what Peter wants us to know is that when we repent, that just means to turn back, to make a U-turn. When we turn back to God at that moment, and baptism is going public of our faith in him, but in that moment when we turn back to God, when we put our faith in Christ, we receive forgiveness of sin. But God doesn't stop there. It's BOGO. It's buy one, get one free. We receive the forgiveness of sin, and he keeps giving because God's a giver. He keeps giving. He gives the gift of the Holy Spirit. You need to know that. The Holy Spirit is a gift. I got stuff back here. The Holy Spirit is a gift. Now, just in case you forgot how this works, and I know we're getting closer to Christmas, but just in case you forgot, this is how a gift works. It's just in case you need a refresher. First thing is a gift requires someone to give something, and it requires somebody to, you're smart, you are, you got an extra hour of sleep, I know. That's a, it requires somebody to give something, and it requires somebody to receive something. See, the moment that it is earned, the moment it is deserved, the moment that it was worked for, it is no longer a gift. It is reward. It is compensation. It is a business transaction. But for it to be a gift, it has to be given and it has to be received. And the Holy Spirit is a gift. You don't earn it. You don't earn him in your life. You don't earn his presence in your life. You receive it. You believe and you receive. In the same way that you receive your salvation, you believe and you receive, and you receive. He's a gift. And the gift makes the difference. A gift can make a difference. I was reminded of this a couple years back. I had a chance to go to Panama with Operation Christmas Child. Not Panama City. Some of you are thinking, well, I've been there. No, it's different than Panama City. It is the Republic of Panama. It's a lot harder to get an airbrush t-shirt there. And so I went... went down to Republic of Panama and was able to see what happens when the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes are distributed and the difference they make. And I met a young man named Luis, and I got to meet him, and I got to hear his story. It's this incredible story about how God got the right shoebox to the right child and how it made the difference in his life. And the story is so powerful that they went back recently and they made a video that tells this story. And when I found it, I wanted to share it with you. Check this out.
I didn't have a father. Living in poverty made my life even harder. And I was begging my mother, please send me to school.
Cuando él llegó el tiempo de que él tenía que entrar a la escuela, le dije a Luis que orara. Porque no tenía los útiles escolares.
The next day, a friend of mine invited me to their church. They were giving us boxes. When I opened my shoebox, all of the school supplies that I needed to go to school was inside my shoebox. That was the first gift I ever received. My mom, she said, now I know that God is real and that he can answer our prayer.
¿Qué es un regalo para ti? Cuando yo tenía 6 años, yo recibí una cajita de esa.
Wow, mira. La mitad de colores.
I wanted to invite children to the church because they could receive a shoebox just as I did. And I was hoping that their life could be changed just as mine was changed.
I love that story. It reminds us, I want to just make this clear. The reason that we participate in Operation Christmas Child, the reason that we pack shoeboxes is not merely that a child can receive a gift. It's that each child that receives a shoebox gift receives an opportunity to hear the truth about Jesus. A gospel opportunity, because a shoebox gift, a gift like this, lasts for a moment, but the message of Jesus, the truth of the gospel, will change a child's life, will change a person's life for the rest of their life, for eternity. And so we want to be a part of that. This is a way that we participate in what God's doing around the world and moving the gospel forward. It's a powerful thing. But I do love the fact of how God gets the right gift to the right child, that he answers prayer. And that you can be a part of answering a prayer around the world. And we pray over these boxes. As a family, we love to get these boxes and pack these boxes. My wife, she absolutely loves this. She gets to use her spiritual gift of acquisition. She goes to Target for Jesus, in Jesus' name. And it's one of her favorite things to do. And so she goes to Target, and as a family, we pack these boxes, and we grab multiples, we grab a bunch of boxes, we each grab one, and we pack the boxes, and we go through, and we put the things in there, and then we pray over the boxes, we're like, God, would you get this to the right child? And then when we open up, and on the inside, we will take our hand, and we'll put our hand here, and we'll trace our hand, and then we'll put a note for the child to put your hand on top of our hand and know that you were prayed for. We'll put a picture of our family in there, we'll just try to personalize it. And then we leave the rest up to God. I say, God, would you get this to the child that needs to get to? And what I love about Luis, what I love about his story is that he got the box that was an answer to his prayer because in that moment he saw, God sees me. God answers prayer. God is not impersonal. He is a personal God. And then his heart is open to receive the truth about Jesus. And you can be a part of that. We get to be a part of that together. And to think that God will take the box and get it to the right child. And you may never hear the story. You may never see it on a video. But one day when we're in heaven, I think heaven is a lot of connecting the dots. And to see how God used small acts done in big love and big faith in significant ways. And so I want to encourage you today to grab a box or grab many boxes and let's fill them up together. And let's watch God move. You know, I'm going to put this back behind the TV because that's where things go. I heard a rabbi say that the Hebrew language has no word for coincidence. I love that. You can say, it's crazy that Luis got that shoebox. But the Hebrew language has no word for coincidence. There are no coincidences with God. Yeah, it's crazy that he got that shoebox, isn't it, with school supplies? You know what would be crazy? Let me go back and get the box again. You know what would be crazy? As if he got the box and he didn't open it. I mean, wouldn't it be crazy? Like little six-year-old Luis, he's like, this is the first gift I ever got. No, he didn't speak English, but like if he was like, this is the first gift, and then he didn't open it. And they're like, you need to open the box. They're like, abracadabra. And he's like, hold on to it like this. Abracadabra, I think that means open the box. But he's holding on the box like this. And they're like, no, but you need to open the box. And he's holding on the box. And they're like, but open the box. He's like, I don't know what's in it. Like, but you won't know what's in it unless you open the box. And he's like, but it might be something that's uncomfortable. Or it might be something, I don't know, how can I trust? And they're like, but you don't know unless you open the box. And it takes faith to open up the gift. And when we talk about the gift of the Holy Spirit, I wonder how many of us are walking around, the box is closed. We're like, I don't have the Holy Spirit, but I'm not opened up to what he would want to do in my life. And really what we're talking about is just saying, God, I'm going to learn to depend on you. I'm going to learn to rely on you. I'm going to learn to keep in step with you. I'm going to learn to follow the prompts of your spirit. I'm going to learn to live in this relationship. And just like Luis, what he was praying for was in the box. You know what the scripture says? Is that when we receive the spirit, that the fruit of the spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. The stuff you've been praying for is in the box. It's been given to you. See, when the Holy Spirit is given to you, the gift of the Holy Spirit is for you. The gift of the Holy Spirit is for you. And so you receive that gift and it's for you. But the gifts of the Spirit, they're for others. Let me say that again. The Holy Spirit is given to you for your benefit. But the gifts of the Spirit are given to you for the world, for you to give to others. That's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about the gifts of the Spirit and how the gifts of the Spirit are for the benefit of others. Now, if you're taking notes, you can write this down. The Bible teaches that the moment that you receive Christ, you receive the Holy Spirit. And when you receive the Holy Spirit, you receive gifts of the Spirit. You receive gifts of the Spirit. Now, hear what gifts of the Spirit are. Spiritual gifts are God-given abilities that he entrusts to every Christ follower for the common good of the body of Christ. If you're taking notes, I'm writing that down. I'll give it to you one more time. Spiritual gifts are God-given abilities that he entrusts to every Christ follower for the common good of the body of Christ. And there are multiple passages that talk about this. Romans 12 talks about this. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 talks about this. 1 Peter 4 talks about this. And those are great passages to read through. We're gonna kind of dial in and look at 1 Corinthians chapter 4. So if you've got a Bible, you can turn to Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to pick up in verse 1. You can follow along in your program. We've got it listed out there. So verse 1. It says, now about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. Let me just stop right there. What Paul is saying is that it's possible for you to go through life and be uninformed or ignorant, to not know about the gifts that have been given to you, the spiritual gifts that have been given to you, which is kind of a scary thing to think that God has given you a gift for you to use for the world, but it's possible for us to go through all our lives and be uninformed. Now, it's not likely that you would go through life and be uninformed about your natural gifts, your athletic gifts, your academic gifts, your intellectual gifts, your artistic gifts. Like, the world tells us about our natural gifts, and the world tells us when we don't have them. That's reality. Reality is what you bump up against. And so the world will tell us when we don't have gifts in those areas, but we can have spiritual gifts that God has given to us, that he's deposited in us, and not know it, which is tragic because you have something that the world needs. There is a spiritual gift that's been given to you that the people around you need, that the world needs, that the church needs, and that you need to use. Because I believe that when we don't live out of our spiritual giftedness, that we rob the world and that we rob the church and that we rob ourselves, because some of our greatest fulfillment and satisfaction in life comes from using the gifts that God has placed in us. And so we don't want to be uninformed. Now, we want to be informed. Our prayer is, God, we want to be informed where our gifts are. And so the thing you need to know is that, and some of you are going, am I gifted? Well, the thing you need to know is that everyone receives a gift. Everyone does. Look at verse 4. It says, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, in who? Everyone. I want to hear you out of Dixon. In who? Everyone. It is the same God at work. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. It says everyone receives a gift. Look at your neighbor and say, you're gifted. Man, I'm going to tell you, like, you should just feel good right now. Like, I was never in the gifted program at school, so I never got to hear that growing up. It just feels good to hear somebody say you're gifted. And Paul is saying, look, we're all gifted. Paul is saying, you are gifted. He's saying, like Oprah, you get a gift, and you get a gift, and you get a gift, and you get a gift. I mean, God is just generously, he's just giving out gifts. And to the person sitting in your seat, God says, you get a gift. So everyone gets a gift. Every Christ follower has at least one gift. And no one person has all the gifts. The only person to have all the gifts is Jesus. And he has put part of who he is in you so that when we come together, and this is genius on behalf of God, when we come together as the church and we bring our gifts, we make up the body of Christ. And so the world experiences something of the presence and power of Jesus as we bring our individual gifts to the mix. And we all bring our gifts together and the world experiences That's why we're called the body of Christ. Now, you also need to know you have a gift, but your gift is not for you. Your gift is not for you. Paul says gifts are for the common good. Here's what he's saying. Your gift is in you for the people around you. Your gift is in you for the people around you. Your gift is an answer to what other people are praying for. So somebody is praying for, just like Luis, he was praying for school supplies, and somebody else's gift was an answer to that prayer. Your spiritual gift is an answer to something that somebody else is praying for. And the interesting thing about spiritual gifts is we can't activate them on ourselves. They're only activated when we use it for others. Like if you had a gift card to a store that you couldn't use if you used it on yourself. But if you use that gift card for somebody else, then it works. And so scripture lists out many different spiritual gifts, and they're all kind of administration, faith. These are just some of them. Administration, faith, evangelism, giving, service, healing, shepherd, miracles, hospitality, intercession, leadership, mercy, teaching, discernment. Like, the interesting thing about these gifts is they only activate when I use them on someone else. So if I have the gift of healing, and I can't use that on myself, but I can use that gift for somebody else. These gifts are given for us to activate and to introduce into lives of other people, and they are answers to the prayers that other people have. And then number three, to use your gifts, you got to know your gifts. And maybe this is new for you and you're like, this is different, but I want to know. I think deep down inside of us, we all want to know, okay, what is my unique contribution that God's put in me? How can I use the gifts? And so to use the gifts, you got to know the gifts. And there are incredible spiritual gifts tests that you can take. There are great tools out there to help you learn your gifts. But you got to think, like back in the New Testament, they didn't have spiritual gifts tests. They didn't have like a URL that you could go to, you know, click on a link and follow along and just kind of take it. They didn't have that. So how did they know their gifts? Their gifts were recognized in the context of community. And so somebody would look at somebody else, they go, you know what, when you do that, like, that really works. Like, when you serve, there's something about the way you serve. When you do that, I see Jesus. Like, you've got a gift of serving. Or when you communicate that passage and you teach, man, I just understand it. I understand it in a unique way. You've really got a gift of teaching. Or maybe, you know what, when you prayed for me, like, I was sick, but something happened after you prayed for me, like, I experienced healing. And so there are these gifts connected to an output, and they go, hey, because of what happened here, you have this gift. So here's what I want to encourage you, is pay attention to the feedback. Pay attention to the feedback that's going on around you, but I also want to encourage you, pay attention to the passion that's inside of you. Because attached to your gift is a passion. And when you use that gift, you feel God's pleasure. There's a joy that comes from using that gift. There's this great quote by Frederick Buechner. He says, the place God calls you is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. Isn't that good? The place God calls you in life is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. And so when you use that gift that God's put in you, there's going to be this fulfillment, this joy, and this satisfaction, but it's also going to meet a need. So you probably have a burden attached to that. So pay attention to feedback, but also pay attention to what's going on in here, to your own heart, because God has hardwired you to use that gift for his glory. And so know your gift, and then use your gift. Look at Romans chapter 12. Let's flip over there together. Romans chapter 12. Take a left, a couple pages. Romans chapter 12, we're going to look at verse 3. He says, for by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. Okay, this is it. He's saying, just because you have a gift, don't strut around. Got a gift. I mean, he's like, don't strut in your gift. There doesn't need to be swagger attached to your giftedness. So don't think of yourself more highly. Your gift works best when you're humble, because the purpose of your gift is not to point to yourself. The purpose of your gift is to point to him. The purpose of you being spiritually gifted is that people would see Christ. Remember, the purpose of the Holy Spirit is to glorify Christ. So the reason that the Spirit gives you gift is that the world would see Jesus. So don't strut in your gifts. Your gift is not about you. Your gift is about Jesus. So don't think of yourself more highly than you ought, but in humility serve. And just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it's to encourage, then give encouragement. If it's giving, then give generously. If it's to lead, then do it diligently. If it's to show mercy, do it cheerfully. What Paul's saying is there, if you have the gift, use the gift. Like, don't be a spectator. Be a participant. Use the gift that's been given to you. Because when you use your gift, the world sees Jesus through you. And don't rob them of that opportunity. And don't rob yourself of the experience. He said, I want you to use your gift so that people will see Jesus. Man, I love seeing Jesus through you using your gift. I think about Sandy out at Mount Julia, who was leading a small group, and she shared that there were 5 people in her small group that were baptized this past summer. Like, way to use your gift. I think about Monroe out at Dixon campus. Monroe had a real passion to build ramps for people who were disabled so that they could get into their homes with their wheelchairs. He's just out doing it. He's just out building ramps. He's taking a small army of people with him, and they're on the weekends, they're building these ramps. I think about Melvin at our Nashville campus. Has a real passion for racial reconciliation. So he's pulling together guys in small groups and studying the scripture together, guys from different walks of life and different backgrounds and ethnicities, pulling them together, guys whose paths might not normally cross, pulling them together so that Jesus can bring unity and oneness. My man, way to use your gift. Think about Connor down in Franklin, who has a real passion for football. Any other guys have a real passion for football? That's your spiritual gift. You're like, yeah, that's my gift. Connor has a real gift, right? He has a real passion for football. How can I use that passion though to help other people come together? So he on Saturdays they play flag football. He has 60 guys coming together on Saturday to play flag football, multiple games going on, not just one big game, but multiple games going on. And they come together and they pray together and they play together and then invite the guys to be a part of the church. I'm like, man, why do you use your gift, Connor? I think about the Bellevue campus, Teresa and David. They lead a small group at Bellevue, and based on their own experience with adoption, just a passion for couples and families who are pursuing adoption, they have a small group for people to help them navigate that process. I'm like, man, what a beautiful use of their gifts. And so it's just going, okay, what gifts have been given and what's my passion and how can I use those gifts for your glory, God? And it takes each one of us bringing our gifts together to make up the body of Christ. I think if you ask me the question, you're like, Kevin, if you could lose any part of your body, which one would it be? Like a pinky toe, an ear, you know? Kevin, what would it be? I don't know. Like, that's a bad question. Like maybe my gallbladder. I mean, if I have to choose, but I think more than choosing, like I'd be like, I'd prefer not to lose any parts of my body, right? And I think God knows that every part of the body is valuable. And just like sometimes the parts of the body that you can't see are the most valuable ones. And maybe you serve in a way, or maybe your giftedness is one behind the scenes. And scripture says, well, that gift should be more honored. Because the internal organs are so valuable. So you've been given a gift. So how can you use the gift that's been given you for God's glory? And so if you want to take a next step, I want to point you to the program or even up on the screen. What we've got up here is we've got a QR code that's going to lead to a site. In fact, you can take your phone. And if you want to do this, you can take your phone and you can put your phone up on the screen and you can kind of zoom in a little bit. And it's going to, did you know you could do that? And your photo, right, your camera on your phone is actually a QR reader. And that's going to take you to a site. You can click on that link and you can take the test. It just takes about 5 minutes and it's going to give you your top 5 gifts. And it's a great way It's not a scientific approach in the appendix of your Bible. I mean, it's just a great tool just to get the conversation going and the process going of finding your gifts. That code is also in your program, so you can use it there and you can get to that site. But then also, if you're going, okay, how do I use those gifts? And we've got an incredible opportunity this month. As we talk about For the One and being a church that sees people and serves people, a church with the heart like Jesus, and as the body of Christ being the hands and feet, we've got a great opportunity. In fact, you can go to crosspoint.tv/local, and you can find projects throughout the month of November where we get to serve. Because remember, they're not about projects, it's about the people. But then it's also about us as the body of Christ using the gifts and the passion that God's given us to make a difference in the world so that they could see Jesus. And so you can go to that site and you can follow along, you can find a project and jump in. And I'm gonna tell you, there's no satisfaction and fulfillment like serving in that way. Remember, the Holy Spirit was given to you for your benefit, but the gifts were given to you for the benefit of the world. And if this is new for you, and like you start getting a little nervous when you think about taking a step and serving, or maybe just kind of just a little bit of uncertainty, or it's uncomfortable, the Holy Spirit is your comforter. And he'll help you take that next step. And remember, you're not a cow. You're a buffalo. So we charge the storm together. I'd love to pray for you. Would you stand to your feet? And I'd invite you, if you just open up your hands like this, if you want to participate in this prayer, you can just open up your hands. And so, Father, we thank you that you're the giver. We thank you that you have given us, we've placed our faith in Jesus. You've given us the gift of the Holy Spirit. And as a church in this series, we're saying, God, we receive it. We receive the gift. We receive the Holy Spirit. We receive him in our lives. And maybe for some, this is the first time they have believed that the gift has been given. And God, we also believe that you've given gifts. And we don't want to go through our lives and squander a gift by not using it. So I pray that today that you would open our eyes to see the gifts that you've given. God, I pray that you would put a passion, and the passion would burn in our hearts, and a burden to use those gifts. And I pray, God, that you would highlight an opportunity for us to take the next step, to use our gifts, not for our own glory, but for your glory, that the world would see Jesus. And would we, wherever the storm is in our lives, would we charge the storm with the grace and with the gifts and with the power that you've put in us? And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.